On this video, we're going to be looking at the education market specifically. It comes up quite often in question. It could crop up on a macro paper, because if there's an increase, say, in the number of students going to university, in the short run, there's going to be a leftward shift of the aggregate supply curve, because people are going to be moving out of the labour market. But as they get their degrees, become more productive in the long run, the aggregate supply curve will shift right. So it's going to be a good one for paper two. Obviously, there's external benefits as well as a number of other aspects on paper one. And because it covers both macro and micro, it's an obvious target for paper three as well. So we're going to be looking at the internalities. In other words, the private cost, which is the cost to the individual going into further or higher education, and the private benefit, the gain that they are going to get. Now, you are all in this market, and I'm willing to bet that when you made your decision to do A-levels, probably one of the most important decisions you ever made in your life economically, you didn't think through the full amount of the costs or benefits. Neither did anybody else, including me. Now, when we look at your private costs, the one that immediately springs to mind is going to be the actual costs of doing your A-levels or later on doing your degree, which regarding A-levels is probably something like, say, a 50 quid reaper graphics fee a year, so it's about 100 quid. However, we're economists, and that means that we also have to look at the opportunity costs of that decision. Now, the direct costs to you doing your A-levels are so small that we can actually ignore them. When it gets to degree level, it gets a little bit more complex. So in 2020, because of maintenance and tuition fees, it's expected that the average student will be leaving university with a debt of somewhere between £30,000 and £40,000. However, most students will never ever pay that back or anything like it. There's a fair chance that by the time those debts are written off in about 30 years' time, an awful lot of students will actually be owing more than that amount. They wouldn't have actually paid off one penny. So effectively, this maintenance and tuition fees are a 9% marginal tax on incomes over currently about £27,000 for a period of 30 years. So I'm going to be making the assumption that the average graduate income over that time, in other words, your income over that time, will be something like £35,000 a year. It could be more than that, could easily be more than that. So what are we looking at? Well, the difference between £35,000 and £27,000 is £8,000. So you will be paying 9% on £8,000 over 30 years, which is just under £22,000. Now, this immediately poses a problem, because we won't know what your private costs are going to be, your direct costs, until we actually know your income, and that could vary vastly from person to person. So your private costs are around about 22k, that's how much you're going to actually be shelling out over the next 30 odd years to pay for your A-levels and your degree. What about the opportunity costs? What could you be doing if you weren't studying? Well, of course, you could be working. Now, the average salary of a 16 to 17 year old currently is about £10,000. And in your early 20s, it's about £16,000. So during the course of your A-levels, you could be making, say, £10,000 this year, perhaps £11,000 in year two, £21,000. And over the 5 years, if you're planning to do a degree, it's going to be something like 10,000 plus 11,000 plus a 13,000, say, that you could have earned in your first year at uni, plus say 15,000 plus 16,000, which gives us a total opportunity cost of 66,000. Now, that is almost three times the direct costs of your education. And that's why the opportunity cost is so important for economists. So in summary, if you decide to give up 5 years of your life in order to get A-levels in a degree, direct costs are about 22,000, the opportunity costs about 65,000, so in economic terms, your private costs are £87,000. So to work out your private costs is actually relatively tricky economically. But obviously, you go to uni and you do your A-levels, the most common answer I get in class is because we are going to get a better job. Now, how much do you think over your lifetime your earnings will be boosted by as a result of that very important economic decision that you took? I'll give you a few seconds to think about that. What's the figure going to be? 10,000? 100,000? 500,000? 2 million, 3 million. Normally, those are the sorts of figures that I get that my students write down when I ask them what their actual thoughts are on that. And a lot of them are going to be way out for obvious reasons. When I went to university, I had no idea either. Well, here's the private benefits on average of just doing your A-levels. Forget about a degree. This is the lifetime earnings gap between you having A-levels, which is regarded as being mid-skilled, and you having GCSEs, which is regarded as being low-skilled. Well, for a man, on average, you're going to be £160,000 better off by having A-levels. Now, remember that the A-levels, the opportunity cost is about 20, 21, 22,000 quid, so it far outweighs the private costs. For a childless woman, it goes down a bit. But the person who would benefit most of all is a woman with two children, £260,000. That's over £250,000 as a result of having A-levels, primarily because if you're a trained person and you're an educated person and you drop those kids, then you're going to be able to get back into the workplace, get back into your job a lot faster. So it's somewhere between £120,000 and £260,000. Remember, that is just A-levels. So according to this study, A-levels in 2011 increased your income by 15% compared with GCSE. GCSEs by themselves added about a quarter to your income compared with no qualifications. However, if you look at those figures for a degree boosts the average income by 85% compared with just GCSEs, a huge figure. Now, you'll notice that the boost of degrees and A-levels is lower than it was, say, in 1993. Reason for that, from an economic perspective, is obvious. There are more students doing degrees, there are more students with A-levels, and that increased supply is going to reduce the premium for getting them. However, on the right-hand side, more than three-fifths of British adults believe, and this is in August 2020, that a degree has no impact on earning potential whatsoever. So we are working within the realms of information failure, because the data clearly shows that they're wrong, but they've not studied that data. Why should they? So in summary, the opportunity cost of doing your A-levels is about 21,000 quid, and the benefit is an awful lot more than that. So you have actually made a good decision, whether you knew it or not. However, most people would have actually made that decision without the going through anything like that. You probably did it because your parents told you to do it, or your friends had done it, or relatives had done it, or in my case it was simply because I couldn't think of anything else to do, and it was a good way of stalling for about 5 years. So brilliant decision. Except look at this study from the Guardian, February 29th, leap year day 2020. One in five students would actually be better off if they didn't get a degree and they'd gone straight into work. So tying this in with the micro spec, well, first of all, you probably didn't know the quantities, you probably hadn't bothered to think about them because people don't tend to do that, information failure. But despite that, you probably made the right decision anyway, which is where we look at alternative views of consumer behaviour, heuristics and other such stuff from section 2 of theme 1. So let's immediately go into that however paragraph for evaluation. Well, the first thing we've already spotted is that the internal benefits change over time. The benefit of having a degree fell between 1993 and 2011, as did the benefit of having A-levels. And it's also going to be affected by things like your gender. Have a look down there. The average salary for an economics degree, one of the highest paying degrees, if you're a male, is £50,700. For a female, it's £46,100, because there is gender inequality. But comparatively, a male is nearly 70% better off by having an economics degree. For a female, it more than doubles the earnings, 121% better off. Second thing that we need to look at is the qualification that you're actually doing. Economics is a particularly well-paid degree. Some of these figures differ from those you've seen before because they're going to be measuring incomes at different stages of people's lives. But economics, you'll be earning nearly £30,000. Accounting, politics, business, and geography, you'll be looking at between 20 and 25. English psychology on average below 20, and that creative arts person 15,000. And that's where we also need to take account of some of the other non-financial sides, which as economists we can't just ignore. So it may well be that these people are doing creative arts because they love creative arts and they get a benefit, they get utility from doing something that may well be relatively low paid. It will also be affected by the university that you manage to get into. You're probably not that surprised that someone like the London School of Economics or Cambridge or Oxford are very highly paid. So is the City University London. So degrees from them are worth a lot more than those at the bottom of the list. Cardiff Metropolitan, 18,000, less than half of that at the top for the average degree. So what I've hoped to demonstrate is that finding the internal impact, the costs and benefits, is actually quite a tricky thing in practice. When we get on to the external, it becomes a lot more difficult. That's enough for this video.